on legislative matters for January 9th, 2017. And we're all here. Notice that we're all here. For public comment, I'm thinking the public wants to comment about a specific thing we're talking about, right? When the public gets here. He called me, said he was coming, so.
Who?
Tony said he was coming.
There's people out there.
Yeah, so they're wanting to speak, I think, on the council rules question. So what I'm thinking is we'll hold public comment to that question because I think they'll want to talk about that. So we'll talk about it when it's on the floor, okay, so.
Do you want me to have them come in?
No, yeah, because when we get to that issue, we'll have them speak then, so, because it's relevant to that question, so. We will get around to that. So we'll go on to approve the minutes of November 14th. Has everybody got them and read them?
I move approval minutes.
Second.
We're good with that? Any corrections or are they all looking good? Then all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? All right, the first thing on the agenda is 16184, an ordinance relative to the operation of heavy vehicles. And it looks like, and this went through transportation parking right here.
Correct.
And it looks like it's like striking the whole thing, is it?
Yeah, it's remove subsection C, which was established about 3 years ago. The reason was there are two streets where it's allowable to drive a truck, commercial truck, Lincoln Avenue, Phillips Place. And on Lincoln Avenue, only in one direction. It's legal. You can't be fined for doing that. So this language is put in to say that if you drive on Lincoln Avenue in the allowable direction, over and over and over again, you're no longer fulfilling the purpose of that being an allowable route, and so therefore you can fine. However, according to the chief of police, this is too confusing, and some of the officers were confused about enforcing the other fines to the other streets, and so her preference is simply to
take this C away.
And seeing as for 3 years, I don't believe it was enforced.
They've ever enforced it because they.
Which I fault no one for, it just hasn't.
It just hasn't happened.
And a larger solution is still necessary, so I support removing it if it helps enforcement.
So she just said that they couldn't know if that person had been fined.
Over
and over. They don't have a way to do that. So in practicality, it meant that her officers didn't feel comfortable finding someone because...
So it was basically never going to happen, so we'll just get it off the books.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Councilor Nash, any questions on this one?
Sounds great. I understand it now.
Oh, okay.
So this was the rewording that you had been talking about in the TPC that the chief was going to do. All right. Now
well,
I get it.
Well, in fact, this had been alongside a more comprehensive ordinance that would have restricted all travel on Lincoln Avenue. But that was removed, and we were just left with this, which we agreed upon, and we're ready to move forward with the other piece.
Okay.
All right.
Excellent.
So I move positive recommendation.
Do we have a second for that?
Second.
Any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. The next one is 16231, an ordinance relative to parking on Center Street. And it changes the schedules, and this also came from transportation and parking. So you want to explain what we're doing with this one? This is Center and Market Street.
Although I would defer to the sponsor, Councilor Moore 4, if she wishes to explain if I can.
Sure. I'm happy to explain it. Actually, the map that you need for this is on
the other
previous
one.
Ordinance. So when you flip that over, you'll find the map. So you all will remember that we removed a 50-minute park spot on Center Street, which was
right by the driveway
for the police station at the request of the chief because it was hard to see coming on off again. In that ordinance, the spot in front of that was supposed to turn into a 15-minute spot. It hasn't yet. In the meantime, some residents of Center Street who live on the other side of the street in the apartment building had said that they very much missed that spot because they would use it to unload groceries because they don't have parking for that building. So since that had not yet been put where the ordinance said, this is to change it to go on the other side of the street on Center to make it easier for them. And if you look at the map, it's
right in between the driveways for the
park. There's a little spot between the curb cuts for TD Bank. Mm-hmm. So it's going to just change it to that. So that is the Center Street one. And then the one on Market Street, there had been a request for a 15-minute spot on Market Street that had been a few months ago. And so this is, we spent a lot of time looking at that request, and there are many businesses on Market. So that request came from Click Workspace, but to help with loading and unloading. But additionally, on that kind of little area, you have multiple businesses, you have a restaurant, you have a laundromat, you have a cafe. And so the spot that is proposed actually is just to the left, if you're facing Click, to the left of Click, and there is a like an alleyway that leads back to a parking lot. And the thought is that it's for a spot where you're getting in and out, having more room
right at the driveway
is easier for people. Mm-hmm. So that is the proposed spot for that 15 minutes.
And it's not too far from Bridge Street. It's down on that end where it's all businesses.
Exactly.
Yeah, because it gets more residential the further down you go.
Right, and there's the laundromat is right on the other side of the alleyway, and mm-hmm. A bunch of other businesses there that right. could use a 15-minute spot.
And this went through transportation and parking already?
Yep, a favorable recommendation.
Excellent. Councilor Nash, you, this is...
These look great.
That's good. This yeah. is your turf where this is going, so... And there's been neighbor feedback on both of these, right? So they
they've been requested and desired.
Excellent. So we got a motion on this one?
Move on favorable recommendation.
Okay, any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, and then 16214 relative to a yield sign on Maple Street. And as I understand it, the yield sign's actually already there. Or did they put it
up
there?
No, I don't believe it
no,
is.
No, it's not there?
No.
Okay. And this also came from transportation and parking. And you want to explain
that? You know, if you're coming up that curve near the Chemiplastica factory from Riverside onto Naugatuck and Maple, there's, like I say, a curve there. And there was a request from one of the residents due to some of the speeding in that area that a stop sign be put there. They thought it would be better just coming out, you know, just to slow cars down. The DPW did an analysis of sight lines, crash history, and traffic volume. Those are the three criterion, and they determined it was not warranted for a stop sign. Where they said, how about a yield sign?
The next best thing.
So, you know, a yield sign is warranted for this location. I think there's a good need for it, and we have to establish it by ordinance.
So. And it's so this is kind of where the street, where the intersection of Naugatuck but Maple, coming down the hill is right across, sort of right across from it.
Right. This would be as you're going up the hill, mm-hmm. or before
you hit there.
Yeah.
So, and isn't the if you're looking left, it's like a real acute angle around to see Naugatuck Street.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think it's that bad.
But it's worth,
to be honest, but it's
worth knowing you're not supposed to just pop out onto Naugatuck Street.
It might be worth looking to the right, actually, depending on where cars are coming from that way.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I think it's worth caution there. There's been a number of accidents on Naugatuck Street itself in different places along the street, so I think it makes sense to be inside that location.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions on this one?
So this is the intersection at the bottom of Maple where there's actually it splits. Is that right?
It's actually on the other
there's
side.
There's a telephone pole and then there's two.
Well, I don't know where the telephone pole is, but you would get to this yield sign from driving up Riverside rather than down Maple. And so you would come up Riverside and then you would
it's kind of across to the right if you're coming down the hill.
Yeah.
And they merge onto Naugatuck Street.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just to tell them, pay attention, you can't just pop out on, because there's nothing there now, you can just drive right out
exactly.
on Dunn Street.
Is that, because I it is a little bit of a confusing intersection.
Well, I'm thinking ahead, so not, I'm hoping I have the right street here. Maple comes down from Florence and runs into Nantucket.
And then it splits.
Right.
And you're right, there is
a
phone in the middle there.
And so you can go, all right.
Yeah.
So that's the intersection.
If you go to the right.
Other side of that. Yeah. Other side of Nantucket. So if you came down the hill from Maple, get the split, you cross Naugatuck.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's still Maple over there?
No. Maple ends at that
it's
intersection.
Riverside.
But if you were to take the right of that split
yeah.
and turn on a Naugatuck, this would be right on your left, the cars coming out of Riverside Drive.
Oh, so there's no stop sign there?
No, there's nothing there.
Exactly.
Yeah, so it would be a little, it actually is nice to have something there so they know they can't just come blasting out on a Nunatuck Street.
Well, the reason they're confusing is because it looks like it's saying northeast is the travel direction, rather that would be more like southwest.
It actually is kind of northeast.
Okay.
Yeah, so
but you know, trust the DPW on this.
We got to trust in which
I was just trying to figure it all out.
Well,
we should have had a map of this too. Sorry about that.
Yeah. Oh, that's okay.
I don't expect you to know about streets outside of Ward 3 and
others. Well, you know, I do drive elsewhere, okay. So. And I hope I'm not breaking the law in Florence, so.
As long as you have a visa to leave.
We'll have a pop quiz next time you come to Ward 5 as to what street you're on. All right, so are we good with this
one? I would move a positive recommendation.
Second on this one? Any more discussion? All in
second.
Favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. We're good with this one. All right. And brings us up to the issue that I think we have public comment on. So what I might suggest, if it's all right with you folks, I'm going to let Councilor O'Donnell explain what happened and what we're changing to get it on the table, and then welcome your public comment on it once he explains what it is. Is that okay with you folks? And
sure.
Then we'll have as much give and take as it takes to get everybody up to speed. So this is 17232, an order to amend council rules, and it was sent at our last meeting to Legislative Matters to work it out and take public comment. Mm-hmm. And then from here, if everybody's satisfied, I'll go back to council to be adopted. And it's only one reading because it's a council rule. So do you want to kind of set the stage and tell us how we got where we are and what we're proposing to change back to?
Yeah.
And then when everybody's comfortable, they know what we're talking about, then we'll have the public comment on it.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think it was two council meetings ago, we adopted a rule change that was sort of technical in nature. It changed the word referred to the word considered, such that, well, here's what it says right here. Actually, it was a different section. But suffice it to say, it said that orders and ordinances just have to be considered by Legislative Matters as opposed to being first referred there. So the idea was that the committee could add things to their agenda like any other committee could do, like the city council can do, duly post them in advance for the open meetings law, and then debate and make a recommendation on it. And I thought there'd be more flexibility. I thought there'd be more perhaps creativity from committees if you gave them the power to originate ideas rather than wait for things to be referred to them. And that went through after hearing from other councilors and members of the public. My impression was that people are more comfortable with the process of referral, so that matters must be referred to committee before this committee acts on them. And so I was sort of fine with that personally. And I thought, let's switch it back to the way it was and require referral from the council to Legislative Matters before Legislative Matters considers them.
Okay, so the original change was so that one committee could send something to Legislative Matters. Legislative Matters could debate it, approve it, send it to the council, and rather than come from the council, it would go live to the council and could be voted on at a meeting, and the only public comment theoretically it would get would be the 3 minutes at council. Is that a?
Well, because every matter, every ordinance would still have to go to Legislative Matters.
Right.
That never changed. Right.
But it could come from another committee to Legislative Matters, or Legislative Matters could come up with it on its own.
Exactly.
And it could send it right to council, and it would be a live ordinance ready to be voted on, because it had already been to Legislative Matters.
Every ordinance has to be considered by Legislative
right.
Matters. The thing that changed was, to get on the Legislative Matters agenda,
it didn't have to go to
it
council.
It didn't have to be referred.
Okay.
And so from what I've heard from people, they don't like that. So in my opinion, that's important feedback from the public and other counselors. And the purpose of this order is to change it back to require referral so that people can follow the process and so forth. Mm-hmm.
So an ordinance now would have to originate in council.
Correct.
And then council would decide where to send it. This used to be the way we did. Council would send it to one or two or three committees.
Yeah.
And then when those committees were done, it would go back to Legislative Matters as its last stop before returning to council.
Correct, and the solicitor under a separate rule would be required to review the ordinance before we acted on it.
Before it left Legislative Matters.
Yeah, this committee is responsible for working with the solicitor
yeah.
to check the legal form and character of the ordinances that go to the council. But if we adopt this rule change, what we could not do is just bring things up within the Legislative Matters Committee.
And send it out to council.
Yeah, so I couldn't say, oh, I have an idea for an ordinance and originate it here. I would have to draft it, put it on the city council agenda, have the city council refer it to Legislative Matters. Legislative Matters would consider it a solicitor, and then we may or may not make a recommendation and go back to the council.
Before it would be voted.
So, back to the future, if you will.
So we're going back where we used to be.
So we've had a period of maybe 30 days where that was theoretically different, and we didn't do anything in those 30 days.
And in fact, that never happened, right?
Right, but I think it's important that people understand the process and that people have confidence in the process. And if that's the process councilors want, then it's certainly fine with me. That's what we've been using.
So. Okay. Yeah. So with this change back, if somebody, one of us had an ordinance, we would give it to Pam. She'd put it on a council agenda.
Mm-hmm.
It'd show up at council.
Mm-hmm.
Council would then send it to any committee that council felt it needed to go to.
Mm-hmm.
When it finished the round, it would go to Legislative Matters.
Mm-hmm.
And then it would come back here. And when it's at Legislative Matters, the solicitor would weigh in on its correct form and everything. So
yeah.
When it came back to council, the committees would all talked about it. It would have gone to Legislative Matters last, then checked by the solicitor. So when it came back to council, it would have been vetted by all those committees, got all that public comment. The solicitor would have said yes, and then it comes back to council.
Correct.
And that would be the result of the change we're going to make recommendation on here.
Yep.
Okay. Is everybody good with that?
Yeah.
Then we'll open it up to public comment and come on up. And there's no time limit on our discussion here. We can.
Well, I don't want to take up all of your time, Luigi.
No, that's fine.
My name is Anthony Patel, Lawrence, Mass. One of the things that we keep talking about, that if we're going back to where it was, and I sort of look at this with the legal form and character, before it came out of ordinance committee, for a positive or a negative recommendation, you now added neutral. It had to be reviewed by the city solicitor for legal form and character. That was explicitly written in the rules. The one that I'm looking at, at least 17.232, it says that it doesn't have it. It says it shall be made in consultation with the city solicitor. And everybody goes, well, legislators can't make laws that are legal. That's true. But also, when we go back to the stormwater management ordinance, it came out of ordinance committee with a positive recommendation without the review of legal form and character before it went to council for full vote. And then we saw what happened after that. That it was illegal, there was all this talk back and forth, amended on the floor, and then voted on. Citizens only had that opportunity to speak 3 minutes at council. And you guys can't respond to that. I couldn't get up and say what I'm saying now. And I want to make sure that stays within our charter, that any new ordinance has to be, before it comes to council, before a full vote, has to be reviewed, the report has to be given, and so the public knows what the final product is going to be before it goes onto the floor for a vote. And this doesn't have that. And people that I've been speaking with are concerned over the transparency issue because of what had happened with the stormwater management and preventing something like that from happening in the future. Another thing is that you've got a 45-day clock on the report. That if the report by the committee that's responsible doesn't generate that report in 45 days, council has authorization to vote on. The committee doesn't have to do anything. They could sit and not respond. Citizens wouldn't know that the clock had ticked off unless they were really responsive and watch things like I do. And I think that's important.
Now, Legislative Matters, typically, this does say that for matters referred to the Committee on Legislative Matters exclusively, the committee shall report in 60 days. but legislative matters traditionally does not review an ordinance sent to multiple committees until all those other committees have weighed in. So sometimes it takes an extra round to wait till all the other committees complete their recommendations, and then it comes back to legislative matters. So if it's just sent to legislative matters, the order says that there's 60 days, but sometimes it may take longer than that if the other committees that it went to did not finish their work and report back, because legislative matters typically will not enact anything until all the committees it was set to have already reported back.
I understand that there's a calendar clock that you folks are working against. And I talked to Council President Bill Dwight about this, and I do understand that. But it still doesn't assuage what I was talking about as far as coming out of these committees, legislative matters, for a vote. And there's got to be some verbiage in here. In consultation with the city solicitor, I would strongly recommend adding the legal form and character. It's got to be in there somewhere. There's no ordinance committee now. So any ordinance coming out goes to legal matters, and legal matters can legislative matters can decide whether or not to act on this or bring it to council. And
yeah, legislative matters was essentially just a change in name from ordinance. We changed the name of it, but it has the same function.
Exactly.
But would it be more palatable if we, in that last sentence, made it more affirmative that things come out with the approval of the city solicitor rather than just consultation?
I that is one point that I really believe should happen.
Councilor Murphy, if I could just point out that there's another section of the rules that has to do with, and this wasn't part of the change, so you wouldn't have seen this. But
is it,
in
is
another
that
section,
rule 36?
It's up. It's actually going up on the screen.
It's section 5.3 where it has solicitor review of ordinances.
Mm-hmm.
It states, at or before the meeting at which the Committee on Legislative Matters considers any matter for approval and or recommendation, the city solicitor may examine the matter's form and legal character.
It says may, and that's a change from wording before. It says shall, and that's a significant issue.
May I offer a comment?
Sure.
Well, it's funny because you're right, you're absolutely right. But the change from shall to may was actually suggested by the solicitor. I'm not trying to make it up, but what's interesting is that this is actually a good point, because the council, because of separation of powers in the new charter, we can't compel the executive branch to do something. So but let me just finish, because I want to actually come
sure,
around to
ahead.
Agreeing with you. We couldn't say the solicitor shall do X, Y, and Z, but the mayor has spoken of changing his administrative order to require the solicitor to do so in the administrative code. Do you know what I'm saying? So it's kind of a tricky legal thing, because I agree that the solicitor should review all the ordinances.
And
we're just having to do that.
And if you look in the charter under responsibilities of city solicitor, it says the city solicitor works for the mayor,
mm-hmm.
but upon recommendation from the mayor, can get legal advice to any city employee. So
yeah,
it's kind of there if he wants to,
mm-hmm.
but if he doesn't want to, he doesn't have to.
Yeah. And that's kind of why, the same reason why we can't, I guess, compel the solicitor to say you must look at our ordinances, because he doesn't work for us. It's kind of strange, but.
Then why is he there?
But aren't you city employees? You get paid by the city, right?
Yeah, but we were.
But still,
yeah. In the charter, we have the legislative function, and in the charter, the employees work for the administrative side, so we have no authority over them. So we can't compel the solicitor. We can ask the solicitor to do it, and the mayor said he's going to have the solicitor do it. But our orders, our paperwork can't compel the solicitor to do anything, because he doesn't work for us. It's kind of strange, but. And so he changed it to this language because he said we couldn't compel him, huh?
We could say the city council shall formally request the opinion of the solicitor on the form and legal character.
That's better.
Of ordinances. That
prior to a full vote of city council.
Mm-hmm. That's at least a little
exactly.
stronger. We shall.
Yeah.
We could compel ourselves to make
the request.
Make the request. I would be fine with that if I, that's probably an improvement.
Any way that we can accomplish this, to me, benefits transparency for the citizens. Because the kerfuffle after the stormwater management thing was, the ripples are still extending. And I want to make sure, in my humble opinion, that that doesn't occur again, and shall does accomplish that. At least it gives people an opportunity to come up and stand where I am before council and get a response back on the issues from you, whereas at public session, you guys can't say a thing.
It's because we can't have this give and take at a council meeting.
Exactly.
You can do your 3 minutes and then you have to walk away.
Exactly.
So let's see what we can craft here. To assure you, I spoke to the solicitor today on everything we're talking about tonight, and in fact, he made a recommendation with the last thing on our agenda that he wanted us to change. So we are, for practical purposes, I'm in communication with him before every meeting to determine whether he should be here, and also to see if there's anything he made any changes in, and he did in the next thing. And I guess according to Councilor O'Donnell, he actually already changed this one, which is why it says what it says.
And the other thing is, before we pass this rule change, if we amend it,
if we amend it, we'll send it back to him before it gets a, we'll send what we do here tonight back to him before it gets to council.
Obviously a different standard for a rule than
an ordinance,
but it's still important. We could change may to shall be requested to, for example, just to put this out there. So 5.3, solicitor review of ordinances at or before the meeting at which the Committee on Legislative Matters considers any matter for approval and a recommendation, the city solicitor shall be requested to examine the matter's form and legal character. That way, something is definitely happening. It's not just, well, it could happen or not.
Maybe we do or maybe we don't. No, right. We shall request his opinion.
Would like to avoid the amendments on the floor where the public has no voice.
Yeah.
To make a statement and get response.
The one thing we can't do with our orders is restrict a counselor when we're talking about the ordinance on council floor from proposing amendments right there. That we can't, there's nothing in our, we just can't do that. We can't say that during a council meeting the counselor couldn't propose a change.
As long as it's germane.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, I couldn't tack on like an unrelated provision.
Yeah, we certainly couldn't do that, and the chair would call out of order. We couldn't decide to change parking meter times in a wastewater ordinance. But I don't think there's any way we could assure the public that when it comes on the floor, a counselor doesn't try and change it at the council meeting when it's being considered.
Well, especially because you could propose an amendment in reaction to public comment that you've heard on that evening.
Yeah, on that evening. And that would be an order if public comment convinces we should, or send it back to the committee, I suppose. But
in any event, so.
Would you read just the last part of that again to see if this helps with your problem?
I mean, this would be, I'll read it first. Yeah, 5.3, solicitor review of ordinances at or before the meeting at which the Committee on Legislative Matters considers any matter for approval and or recommendation, the city solicitor shall be requested to examine the matter's form and legal character.
It sounds great.
Okay.
And double some of the details in reading the final product.
So is that a motion?
Yeah, I would make that motion. It would be in addition. I think it's acceptable because it's germane to the
issues. It is, to the what we're talking about.
So I would just say add that amendment to this order.
All right. We got a second on that one?
So I have a question.
Sure.
So for example, right now we're changing the proposed ordinance.
Mm-hmm.
Is the solicitor going to get a look at what the changes we're making here and per our request? And how do we know, is there a way we can have it clear that he's checked off on that?
Yeah, what we'll do is make sure Pam has it.
He stops by every Thursday and I review with him all orders and ordinances that are requested. All ordinances for sure get his review. Since you've requested that he review this one, he'll get it and sign off on it.
Before it returns to council.
Okay.
Yeah. So we'll accomplish that
Yeah, see, he gives me a signature on all the documents that he needs.
So if that doesn't happen, it doesn't go to council? Right?
It shouldn't.
It won't go to council for first reading.
Until you see it.
Okay, so that means...
So it might go to committee, it might get referred out to committee.
Right, that's okay.
Depends on timing, but it won't go back for first reading until I get a signature.
So our request is being fulfilled by the solicitor doing that?
And this order change got sent here last Thursday. We've effected this change based on public comment. He'll see it this coming Thursday, and then the subsequent Thursday, it'll be back at council with this change approved by the solicitor. So we will have accomplished our desire that he will have seen it before it shows up at council for a vote.
And the final draft after he approves it would be published where?
In the minutes for...
After the city solicitor approves it?
Yes.
Well, after the council votes on it, it will be put on the city's website.
So again, so that's after the council votes on it.
It'll be on the agenda.
But it'll be on the agenda for a week from Thursday after the council, after the solicitor sees it. And, you know, I'm sure if you want, Councilor Barth can find out if the solicitor okayed it, if the change made it through, because it'll be in your, the final version of it will be in your packet if you want to.
Right.
And that packet is also available on the city's website.
Yeah, it's always attached to the agenda.
Yeah, and you'll get it in your packet, so you'll know that it's, that it made it. You know that he approved it the way we changed it.
Councilor, and some people do have a problem with the website of trying to get into some of the ordinance. I just want to let you know that.
Mr. Patillo, if you look up on the screen, I'm on the department list right now. I'm going to click on City Council.
I think we went over this problem on the phone. That I was clicking on packet as opposed to the PDF.
Yeah.
No, this is something different. This is, you'll see, this is the city council's webpage, and to the far right, you'll see rules.
Yep.
If you click on that tab, it'll bring up the city council rules, and these are the ones that are on our website right now, the ones that were approved on November 17, 2016.
Well, I think what he's looking to do is be able to see the agenda for the next council meeting.
Yeah.
To see if the language
the language we're changing here
yeah.
survives the solicitor and is going to go to council the way we changed it.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's what you want to check on, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
To make sure our change survives the solicitor on Thursday.
Because the rules that are there, the rule 36,
are the old ones.
Yeah. And that rule 36 had that clause of shall in it.
Okay.
These don't.
Yeah. All right. So with that. Would the new version of it that we vote on be posted online, or would Councilor LaBarge have to check on that for him in the packet?
It'll be part of the packet. The ones that you're talking about here,
yeah.
I'll make the amendment to the document itself, review it with the solicitor. It won't show his signature, but it will show the changes on the document, and then that will be part of the city council agenda for Thursday the 19th.
So the entire text of this will be in the agenda
right.
document, so you'll be able to see it there.
The minutes.
I don't know if this is what you reviewed with Pam, but I find the easiest way to get the agenda is if you go to the calendar, which is down, if you scroll to the bottom of the city webpage and click on the calendar and just go to the day, when you click on that meeting, it'll bring up where the agenda is.
And you get the PDF for the...
Yeah, and then you get
for the agenda.
That's sort of the best way that I do it.
So I'm still figuring this out. So let's say that the solicitor says, you know what, this language is crazy. Here's a better way to write it. Then it comes back to us, right? It doesn't go to council then.
It probably would go to council. Because if
so, let's say they didn't like this clause. He didn't like the clause we put in. He says, nah, keep it the same. Sends it to council.
Then it would be up to council what to do with it again.
Uh-huh.
Because it was there once and council sent it here. So if the solicitor makes a substantive change that makes it less clear it's supposed to go to him, then it's going to appear at council, we're going to see it isn't what our wish was, and then we'll send it back to committee again.
Okay.
Well, I would never change a document to reflect what the
right.
counselor said.
What the What the solicitor said.
What the solicitor said, right. I wouldn't do that. I would give you what the...
Right. The recommendation.
The recommendation from the committee, and then advise you what the solicitor suggested.
Okay. So there'd be no way we'd miss that.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that's what we talked about.
Would it come back with the solicitor suggests this language, and then we could determine if it is, you know, if it's wishy-washier than shall, then we can decide to keep working on it and not vote on it.
Okay.
Councilor Barge?
Yes. Why, say that the city solicitor does take a look at that and says, no, forget about that. This is what I'm recommending. Why would it go back to city council? Why not back to legislative matters and have the people be able to come and talk about the changes that they're seeing from the city solicitor? Why write to city council? We're going right back to what he just stated about 5.2, about the transparency part.
Yeah, it would come back to council so council could decide what to do with it, which may well be send it back here again.
But would you vote on it?
It's up to the council.
That's what I'm saying.
Because we're here today because something went to council that council didn't want to vote on and they sent it here. So if it comes up at council again and the solicitor has been ambiguous about what we want, it just comes back, the council could send it back here again. You know, we'd have to consciously approve something that got changed on us that we didn't want to do.
But either way, wherever the solicitor's suggestions are adopted in this committee or in council, the solicitor still reviewed it. And that's, I think, the important point, is that before it gets to the council, the solicitor reviews the ordinance.
Yeah, and then if we don't, if it doesn't say what we want with his review, we just continue doing what we try another version, see if he likes that, or maybe he sends us language that's as good in our opinion as this is, and we decide it's okay. I mean, but it'll with this change and his approval, it'll show up at council. If he doesn't approve it, it'll still show up at council, and we'll just keep working on it if we don't like it.
So, question. Our city solicitor only looks at the ordinances once a week on a Thursday, correct? And by rights, we are saying he is not our city solicitor. Is that what you're saying?
Well, the charter says he works for the mayor.
Exactly. So maybe it's something that a city councilor should be looking at of hiring our own attorney. I mean, once a week. I mean,
that's
something to look at.
I think that question's a little long. We're beyond our scope for tonight.
I know, but it's a lot of, we've said this many times.
I think former Councilor Adams brought that up once, that we should have our own attorney. I don't think it went very far.
I agree with it.
That's a little beyond the scope of tonight. But with this proposed change, have what we've done tonight been satisfactory at this point? And we'll send it through the system and see if it makes it?
I think it's a great step in the right direction. Again, the more transparent that citizens know what the final product that's going to be voted on, the better. And how you achieve that, it's in the details. The devil's in the details.
And I mean, we've been talking about this for, 20 minutes? And if that solves the problem, it's time well spent. And
right. If this had happened for the stormwater management, it would have been a whole other story. This place would have been packed. And don't want that to happen ever, ever again.
So if we're good with this the way it is, we didn't vote on this yet, right? We just...
Amendment
on the floor, but we didn't vote on the amendment yet.
No.
So the amendment was made and seconded?
Yep.
Any more discussion then? Then all in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
Aye.
So then back to the order as amended. Yeah. All right, we good with that? We want to make a motion on that one?
I just wanted to ask a question about
the
2.5.5.
Oh yeah, there was one other change, 2.6.2.6.
Well, I think it's 2.5.5, but I just wanted to ask a question about that particular section.
Which section?
This is...
did I say 2? I said 5.2.5. Did I keep saying 2.5?
Yeah.
Yeah.
5.2.5.
5.2.
God, who came up with this numbering system? Fire numbers. It was me.
Okay.
Sorry.
All right, so we're adding five, oh, with the 45 days.
Yeah, so I just wanted to ask, though, if, should a committee fail to report within the same time set forth in section 2.6.2.6? Does that mean that if it's not in 2.6.2.6, that it, that the default will be 45 days?
Yes, it does.
So,
and, oh, I'm sorry.
So my understanding would be that the multiple member bodies would primarily follow that category.
That's right.
Because I'll be the one tracking that for a while.
Yeah.
Get that right.
No, that's right. That 45-day window would apply to executive commissions like Transportation Parking Commission, Energy and Sustainability, but then all of our committees have more defined reporting dates and times, basically from 60 to 90 days. You know, I mean, if that's a concern, I would actually be fine. We got along fine without that provision before. I would be fine if that section just applied to multi-member bodies.
Though, did not, this, relative to the next issue, did not the solicitor indicate that we can't affect those are the multi-member bodies that are not of this body are kind of outside our jurisdiction. Can we do this to them?
Well, I mean, the solicitor did approve that provision. The difference is we're binding ourselves. We're not saying that the Transportation and Parking Commission must do something. We're saying that we can't do something until they report back to us. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
That's the difference. So we're tying our own hands voluntarily.
Because I'm all in favor of compelling us to act and not,
okay,
you know, pigeonhole things so they hang around.
Okay.
We should be dealing with them. I just want to make sure that any requirements we make don't interfere with our tradition of waiting for this committee to deal with things once everybody else has weighed in, so that every, you know, at every step,
yeah,
people have had input that winds up back here before we consider, and then we adopt the changes.
That's true, and there's also kind of other scenarios you could game out. Not, you have to think sort of like not just about this council, not just about the current chairs of the committees, but what if in the future you had a committee with someone who really wanted to hold something up, and that person said, I'm going to refuse to have a vote in this committee, so it's never going to come back to the council, and it's something that the public really wanted, but one person was holding up an ordinance. So that's the other side of the coin in terms of good government. Do you want to empower a committee to hold up something in committee forever, or is there a window at which it stops? And there's probably a balance there. Because also you would want committees to do their job and actually review things, but you wouldn't want them to be able to bottle things up like they do in Congress, for example. They just hold stuff in committee.
But I'm thinking in that scenario, if one of the committees was intentionally delaying something,
yeah,
council as a body could then suspend rules and say, deal with it,
yeah,
Committee on Legislative Matters, because this committee is being, the chair over there is being obstructive.
That's
so
true.
we will suspend that rule of hearing from that committee and bring it right back here.
Yeah, by two-thirds vote.
By two-thirds votes.
But still.
Yeah, it would be a way to short-circuit a rogue committee from holding up something the council wants to take action on.
Exactly. So if it were the preference of the committee, and the public sort of like this too, I mean, we could certainly remove part of this section in 5.2.5. It could simply read, should a multiple member body fail to report within 45 days of referral to that body, the city council shall be authorized to proceed with the matter in the absence of such report. In other words, you know, we say if we send it to the mayor's commission and the mayor's commission never gets back to us, we can still act.
We could still act.
But that doesn't apply to crucial committees like Legislative Matters. We wouldn't have a clock on Legislative Matters.
So, And then for relief, the entire council could, with the supermajority, suspend rules and say, deal with this, don't hold it up anymore.
It's true.
Yeah.
Although the rule of solicitor review would still...
is still there.
Would still be,
What I might suggest on that 5.2.5 is that we bring that to the, leave it the way it is and bring it to the attention of the full council. You know, so that everybody gets to weigh into it that isn't in the room tonight. So we'll leave it the way it is now,
okay,
and then bring it to, let the full, you know, when this comes, change comes up, we can say, we had this discussion.
Okay.
What do you, you know, is it your pleasure to leave it the way it is or not leave it the way it is? But that really pretty much just affects our timing, understanding the council can always suspend rules and override any of the timeframes if somebody's intentionally delaying something that's against the public interest.
Yeah, and as a practical matter, I can't think of any time where a committee really has held something up.
No.
I'm just trying to game it out in the future if you had, you know, someone who was really,
evil,
I don't know, for
intent,
political reasons or whatever,
yeah,
was trying to scuttle something in the public interest.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I'm fine leaving it to the council.
On this one part.
Only on that amendment, yeah.
So we have the entire document now that's been moved and seconded. Are we all good at this point as far as public comment is? We're good.
Okay.
We're good.
Thank you for your time.
Councilor
you.
Nash, do you have a
2.6.2.6.4. Committees shall make all reports in writing. Is there a deadline associated with this?
Yeah, that's what we were just talking about.
Oh.
Yeah, it says up further, if you go up with the versions. So all the committees other than this committee shall report to the council and this committee in 6 days.
And that's the report in writing.
Exactly.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. So are we good with this one then?
Mm-hmm.
The motion. We'll move it second. All in favor of it as amended?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All right, then our last agenda item for the evening is sneaky stuff on the second page.
I would like to move it with the anticipation of continuing because I'd like to make that.
Okay, so I'm just going to read the number off so anybody watching the home version of the meeting can know what we're talking about. It's 17.233, and it's an ordinance relative to establishing school zones. Right.
May I explain it just in case
sure.
You have questions about it? This time?
Yeah.
This would update and expand our school zone ordinance. As written, it would, number one, delete a lot of verbiage about how school zones were supposed to be established previously. It had all this language about referring to the school committee and the Board of Public Works, which of course doesn't exist anymore, et cetera, et cetera. The last two provisions are deleted on page 3 because all that language does is try to replicate what state law says and what Mass DOT regulations, which are required by state law, says. And it does it very imperfectly. It's confusing. So let's just go by state law, which is the authority by which we establish school zones. It would correct the name of the college church school, Cutchins program now. It would add the Montessori school, an industrial drive in Bates Street. It would add Smith College school, campus school on State Street and Prospect Street. And it would expand Bridge Street, which is a school zone that is currently on Union and Parsons, but strangely not Bridge. It would add Bridge Street. And personally, I think that would empower us to add a flashing light there, because it's the only elementary school in the city that doesn't have a flashing light in a school zone, like Ryan Road and Leeds and Jackson Street do. So those are the changes. I anticipate in transportation parking there could be discussion about other school zones. There may be one or two that could be added. So that's why we should wait today. But that's what the ordinance does.
Mm-hmm.
And I would just move.
So we want to move it and second it and then move to continue it.
Can I make an amendment quickly? Just to satisfy, so we don't forget. This is what the solicitor asked.
Well, did we move it to get it on the floor, or do we?
Did we?
No.
I'd like to move it to get it on the floor.
In a second. Okay, now you want to make it, you want to move it a bit.
Sorry about that, yeah. Now I move that we delete section A and change section B to section A. Section A reads, the city council shall establish no school zone in the absence of a favorable recommendation from the Transportation and Parking Commission.
Mm-hmm. And that's the one that the solicitor brought to our attention, that
mm-hmm.
that's not one of our committees, that's an administrative committee, and we can't compel them to do anything because they're not our committee.
True. Although, well, do you want to second this first before we discuss it?
I think so.
Second. Cool. All right. Well, it's true, but I don't even know if I agree with that, actually. Because
that pesky solicitor.
It doesn't say the transportation and parking shall. It says the city council shall. Mm-hmm. We tie our own hands. Mm-hmm. So we're not going to change our ordinance until we get it. I don't think that's a separation of powers issues. However,
we're gonna vote on this change, and then we're gonna continue this for further discussion at transportation board. To go on transportation
park.
Okay.
So that's my. I would move to delete that.
All right, and we have a second for that. Any more discussion on the deletion of
A?
The section known formerly known as A.
Is our administrative assistant out of comment?
Well, the wording of that seemed particularly strange, that you would only establish a school zone with a favorable recommendation from the TPC.
Mm-hmm. As opposed to?
To a neutral.
So if they came back with no recommendation, you wouldn't establish a school zone.
Or a negative.
Sorry, but negative. I'm just trying to prevent future councils again from establishing school zones around a Dunkin' Donuts because they feel like someone asked for it. You know?
A doggy daycare.
Yeah, a doggy daycare.
But it, you know, at the same time, you know, we'd have a hard, you know, at the committee. Well, it's sort of hard to compel the council to not do what it wants, even if a committee makes a negative recommendation.
No,
you know?
True.
I mean, it could come back with a negative recommendation. The council will say, "Well, I'm glad the three of you didn't like it, but the rest of us do, and we're going to do it."
And in theory, the solicitor would review it, and if it doesn't conform to the state criteria,
then we change it.
Not, yeah.
All right. So we have this amendment here. Are we ready to vote on the amendment?
Yes.
Okay. All in favor of the amendment to remove A?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Aye.
And with that, now we're going to move to continue this till and a second on that. So it's going back to TNP, and then it will return at some point in the future.
Correct.
Okay. Good.
Thank you.
Then all in favor of continuing 17.233, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed. And I think with Pam's approval, we may have reached the end of our exciting agenda. Is there any new business that was not anticipated? No. Then hearing none, any motion?
So maybe if I'm out of order here, I just have a few thoughts on the school zone. Is now a good time to share it, or?
Well, the chair would tell you are technically out of order, but it's certainly.
But since we're all here,
okay.
I'm a
all right.
friendly and gregarious person.
Well, first I just wanted to
just don't get out of line. Or we'll have to shut
down. All right. So I'm on the board of Cutchins, so that's one of the programs here, but I'm not going to talk about that. I think this is a great idea. This is, you know, that, you know, especially for Bridge Street, also on Bates Avenue, Montessori School, that this seems to be at a lot of the choking points for commuting.
Exactly.
And so the one thing that I, so the criteria for a school zone, so we're going by the state now? Okay, so would Nonotuck qualify for that, or would like Heck Academy, or I'm just my other worry is that the reason I want to talk about it here is because the criteria that we're going by here will determine what gets set out there. There's all sorts of schools that if we're kind of vague about it, you know, we could end up with People's Institute.
Very strict criteria.
Yeah, but what we're doing is we took the state criteria out of the ordinance, but it still is what it is, and we still have to abide by it.
Yeah. No, thank you, Pat. I mean, that's, and actually, come to think of it, I probably should have brought the state law and the section of the Massachusetts Amendments to the Manual on Uniform Control Traffic Control Devices here today. Section 7EA, I believe. I will do that for the next meeting, and I'll bring it also to the Transportation and Parking Commission, because there are, as Council Chair says, strict standards. So just very briefly, biker building does not qualify because there is actually no sidewalk on the other side of the street. So children have no need to cross.
They don't cross.
So that's right. Not warranted. And also, the state law says you must, the only schools that are eligible are grades 1 through 8.
Right.
You can question the wisdom of that. Why not a high school? I don't know. You can go and ask Boston why they decided to do
that. Well, I'm glad you mentioned that too, because when you look through our list here, it goes up to the middle school, but the high school is not, it's not available to them by state law.
And so, for example,
which is why they wander all over the road.
Councilor Sherrod found this discrepancy, actually, I believe.
Nice.
Our ordinance currently says in 312.17a5, one of our criteria, the school must contain one or more grades below grade 9. Well, it's kind of correct, but it's not really, because it's out of conformance.
It's up to 8, not below 9.
And it's 1, minimum is 1. So there's a minimum, too. You can't have it at preschool, you can't have it at a kindergarten.
So that would pretty much take out the FICR school.
It takes out the FICR school, takes out any daycare.
People's,
Meadowlark. Mm-hmm. People's Institute, and then that's more of a daycare than a school.
There's a lot of pesky state laws and regulations.
Oh, the kindergarten. Okay, so thank you. That disqualifies it for that reason. And then the other issue I point out, and I'll point out just as parking, is just because we don't put it in now does not mean we've made a decision against doing mm-hmm. so in the future. But I agree with, actually, I appreciate that you brought that up, Councilor, because to debate this issue, it's crucial that people know what the state criteria are, mm-hmm. or else there will be confusion, and people will feel left out. So,
I'll try
and make an effort to do that.
I looked at the state criteria.
Oh, yeah.
And then I went back to this, and I'm like, well, I don't need to worry about that. I need to worry about it.
Okay, yeah.
And now I know I need to read it. Okay.
Yeah.
I'll make a note to the next council president in our next session that Councilor Nash has an affinity for TNP issues and maybe should be considered for that committee. That'll teach him to act up for it. Off to TNP he goes. All right, so
I'm done.
With that said, these guys are now working on recipes over here or something.
It's fine.
Any reason we should not adjourn? And if there isn't, somebody make the motion.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Excellent. Thank you all.